So this lecture will be a little bit shorter because of some technical issues. So let us remind what was on the first lecture. I introduced the main object really in the differential geometry. It's metric. Metric, what should you think about this object? This is just a scalar product that acts on the pairs of tangent vectors and calculates their scalar product. So it has some standard characteristics like linearity, positive definition, if you can consider the Riemannian geometry. It should be symmetrical also. So the all standard properties that scalar product has, this object also has. But in our case, now we consider on the surfaces, two-dimensional surfaces in three-dimensional Euclidean space, but this scalar product, it depends on a tangent plane. So actually you also can think about this object like if it was a gram, I think it calls like that, Gramian matrix. So this matrix is just is a components of this tensor. So these components that you have here in this matrix depends on the point where you consider the tangent plane. Okay. So there is some different notations, and probably this is the most difficult thing to understand, that the different notations refer to the same object. For example, this matrix, if we have two-dimensional surface, classically it is written in this form. So this is symmetrical 2x2 matrix. This is component JJ. IJ is from 1 to 2. So G11 is just simply E, and so on. Also, this object can be written down in the following way. So you write down these things. This is a simple notation for the small length, for the length of the curve. So it is classical notations. It means that you have some parameter S on a curve, yes, that lies in your surface, and you want to calculate the length of this tangent vector. So this is what you have on the left hand side of this formula. Of course, this length should be calculated as the length of the tangent vector to the surface, and it should depend on the basis in this tangent plane. I remind that there are two bases, R1 and R2. R is just a map that goes from some domain in R2 into R3, and this map parameterizes our surface. So actually this is a vector. Each component of which depends on two parameters. So, and R1 is just is derivative of this vector along first variable U1, R2 is, well, you see. So this is another notation for the same thing, and it is usually is written down by the following. So what? Yes. This is simply the notation. So if you have this notation, it means that the coefficient that stands beside this is should be written down as g11, because this is the differential of the first variable, and so on. Notice that here you have not a wedge product, yes? The wedge product between two differential forms, but this is a symmetrical product. Well, the symmetrical product on tensor fields. So it's up until now you just consider this only as a some different notation for the same object that calculates the scalar products of the tangent vectors. Okay, what next? Next, I would remind. No, next I will define what the curvature is from the classical point of view. So we had a surface, a tangent plane, a basis R1 and R2 in the tangent plane. Now we should have the normal vector. It is easy to see that it can be calculated by the following formula. So you consider just the vector product of two tangent vectors. Of course, you get the normal vector for this tangent plane. Also, we normalize this vector, so it should be of the unit length at every point. Next, what? Next, we want to calculate the second fundamental form. For this, we should consider the vectors of second derivatives. This is just the following. Okay, this is just vectors of second derivatives, it's simply. So the second fundamental form is just the standard scalar product. This is a scalar product in R3 on M. It is easy to see that this vector, this matrix is symmetrical too, because partial derivatives you can they commutate. Simple partial derivatives they commutate. So it is easy to see that this matrix is symmetrical. But of course, this matrix cannot be positively defined, and usually it is not. Just the classical notation is the following one. So this is also the second fundamental form. Actually, I forgot So there are some letters K, L, and M, I think. This is the classical, yes. So you, I mean, just for the some basic knowledges, you should know that Gauss used this notation. But of course, this is some old-fashioned notation. So and so now we have the first quadratic form, the second quadratic form, and what can we do if we have two quadratic forms, one of them is positively defined. So it is easy to see that in this case you can consider the characteristic polynom of these two quadratic forms. So there is a theorem in algebra which states that if you have such quadratic forms, there is some basis in which these first quadratic forms have just, this is Kronecker symbol, or just simply the identity matrix. So there is a basis in which the first quadratic form looks like this, and the second quadratic form, it is diagonal. It is diagonal. So these two entities, they called principal curvatures. Principal or main, I'm not sure exactly, curvatures. And this theorem from algebra, it just states that there is some basis in which these two forms have this very good forms. But it doesn't state how should you find this basis. So to find this basis, you should consider this this equation. Actually, it has the following view. It's equation on the variable k, and it is easy to see that because the second and the first quadratic forms, their matrices 2 by 2, this equation should be of the second order on k. So minus something, which of course depends on second and the first quadratic forms, and it's some kind of trace of second multiplied by first minus one. Okay, plus determinant of the second quadratic form equals zero. So you find two roots of this equation, k1 and k2, and they will be exactly the same as here. Yes. And then one of the main definitions is the following. Gaussian curvature K is just determinant of second quadratic form divided by the determinant of the first quadratic form. And because of everybody knows Wied theorem. This is k1 multiplied by k2. Also, it is easy to see that if you have this equation, there are two invariants of these equations. If you divide this equation by this coefficient that stands behind this square of k, you have this coefficient and that coefficient. That coefficient will be just Gaussian curvature, and coefficient that stands here, it is mean curvature. So h divided by 2. This is the mean curvature. So this is definitions, and probably I should calculate something to calculate this. Just it is easy to understand that for example plane in a three-dimensional space has zero curvature. How should you understand this? Because R, so what is R if this is, this map parameterizes the simple plane in R3? You have some point x0 and you have two vectors, alpha and beta, for example. This is point and this is vectors. So all the plane will be parameterized by the following formulas. U1 here, or plus beta U2. Okay, so you see that this dependence between U1, U2 and R, this dependence is linear. So when you will consider this, the vectors of the second derivatives, they will be identically zero, all of them. So it means that the second quadratic form is zero identically at every point of the plane, and of course it means that the thing will be zero too. So plane is not interesting, it is flat. Usually you call some manifold flat if it has zero curvatures. Also it is easy to see that this thing is also flat. Everything is flat on the plane. It's not correct phrase that everything is flat on the plane. The plane itself is flat, but there is some different curves on the plane, but this is different story. Okay. Sphere. Of course, one should think that sphere should have some constant curvature, because geometrically it is very symmetrical set. You can rotate it as you want. Yes, and in any point this surface looks like at the like in the other point. For example, for I don't know. By the way, this is the same true for the plane. For example, if you have torus, then it is not true. You see that near this point, for example, the neighborhood of this point looks like this, yes, locally. And if you consider this point, near this point, the neighborhood looks like this, like a saddle, and this like a cap. So these two points geometrically are different. Okay, for the sphere. Well, there is some standard formulas that I just don't want to remind, but I think it is necessary. Actually, you can permutate all these cosines and sines, and what should you have? Only just this equation to hold. Doing all these calculations, you should calculate R1 and R2, then you get the first quadratic form. Actually, it should look like I'll check. Well, it will look like something like this. R1 by R1. So the first, if you consider U1 to be phi, for example, and U2 to be theta, then differentiating by phi, it will be R1, and you differentiate all this vector by phi. This will not be zero. Yes, this will be cosine. Then you calculate the lengths of R1, and it will be equal just R squared. It is easy just to calculate. I don't want to repeat all this simple calculation. And then R2 by R2. This R2 is a vector that you get from this vector. This is vector R, of course, it depends on two variables. Then this third component will be zero, and you sum the squares of this and this derivative by theta, and you get what? You get R squared cosine squared phi. Yes? So this will be the first quadratic form. The normal vector, it is easy to see that you should just divide your vector R by scalar R, because if you have a point that actually is this vector is vector R, and the normal vector has the same direction, yes, but it should have the unit length. So this is very easy to calculate, and then you calculate the second derivatives and calculate the scalar products, and eventually what you will have, that the second quadratic form is just R0 0 R cosine squared phi. You should do some calculations to calculate this, but they are trivial. So we see that when we eventually calculate this thing, so k1 will be equal to k2 and will be equal 1 over r. So at every point, you have the same main curvatures. The Gaussian curvature will be equal to 1 over the r squared, and the mean curvature will be 1 over r. By the way, what is the geometrical meaning of this this main curvatures? There's the following. Imagine you have a point and you have a vector, a normal vector m from this point. And you consider a plane that contains this normal vector. This plane intersects your surface along some curve. Yes? Curve. But this plane, it depends on an angle. You can rotate this plane around this vector m. So you will get different curves here. Yes. So actually, you can define what the curvature of the curve and k. Actually, it will be, So this curvature will be between k1 and k2. So this is the curvature of the curve that depends on this angle phi. So actually, this is the minimal and the maximal values of this curvature of the curve that you can get by intersecting your surface by this normal plane. Okay. And so, by the way, you can, from this, you can understand what, how your surface should look like if the curvature is negative. For example, if the curvature is negative, it means that as it is a product of two main curvatures, it means that they have different signs. It means that if you have a point, a normal, there is some direction in which the curve is curved to one direction, and there is also another direction in which this curve curved into another direction. You see, yes? So this is curvature that goes down, roughly speaking, and this curvature goes up. So, and you see that actually it should be a saddle. You see. So this is one, K1, for example, and this is K2. They curved in opposite direction, one up and another down. And if the curvature is positive, it means that both of these main curvatures curved to the same direction. For example, like this and that. And you have some cap. Actually, this is cap and this is cap. If someone is familiar with some terminology from homological algebra, there is product. One of them called cap product. And another called cup product. This is some products on the algebra of cohomologies. But this is different, absolutely different story. Okay, what next? So this is the geometrical meaning for this thing. Also, I want to remind that some notation that will mostly be used next. For example, when we write down this and that, this is the components of the they called, I think, covariant components, yes? And these components called contravariant. So there are different types of bases. Roughly speaking, you can think of this as that it has some matrix, yes, just matrix. This will be the inverse matrix of this. So, roughly speaking, the following is true. And for example, if you want to multiply Gij by Gjk, so you multiply the straight matrix over the inverse matrix, you will get the identity matrix. So identity matrix is just the Kronecker symbol, it's just the same. If someone don't remember, it's just one if I equals k and zero if else. It is easy to understand that it's just the identity matrix. Actually there is some different terminology for this. For example, this is metrical tensor. And if you have, for example, two indices here, it means that you have two vectors, and if you have zero indices up, then this tensor goes to just scalar field. From the geometrical point of view, you just get two vectors and calculate its scalar product. Its scalar product is scalar. Another example is curvature that we will consider later, curvature tensor or Riemann tensor. It has this, usually it has the following indices. You can put this index down by multiplying it on metrical tensor. But what can you think of this? So you have three indices down. It means it acts from the third Descartes power of some vector space. Of course, vector space is a tangent space to some manifold. And it goes to vector space again because Here you have one index, yes? So it's just some notation from tensorial algebra, and it is useful. And for example, if you consider this notation, ij, kl, and here some another tensor with indices jk. It means this notation, it means that here you have double sum over j and k's. So it will be some different tensor, but by summing the indices j and k's, you kill these indices, and what is left is indices I and L. So this is Einstein notation. I think notation or agreement. This is just to make all these formulas a little bit easier. So when you see the same index down and up, you should think of this as a summation over this index, and all this term actually does not depend on this index because you have summation. It will be widely used next. Okay. Actually,